Well, we have less people than we used to.
That's one thing. Like, luckily, we have a pretty big freshman class this year.
Yeah, you're still
recruiting. Next couple of years, it'll be okay. But
yeah, because my professor was telling me that his studio was rebuilding, like, from the ground up. Like, they're all freshmen.
Yeah, right?
Yeah. Yeah, when I went over here last year, I remember that.
But it's happening. That's why we're pushing recruitment so much.
It is.
There's across the country, there's just less people. Like, our generation.
Are you saying
less kids?
Are you saying that not having any government support for medical expenses has caused us not to have a
not to want to have children and stuff? Yeah.
Interesting.
Wow.
Yeah.
Are you saying this is about Jesus?
Yeah. But this is the first generation that has. There are less people being born than the previous one. So there are less people graduating.
Of course.
So even if the people started having more kids tomorrow, it's going to be 18 years before.
Of course. It's staggering me, the short-sightedness of the people in charge. Mm-hmm. People who maybe care about money. It's like, it's insane.
But,
So we got, but anyways, we're all fighting over a smaller pool of people.
Yeah.
But it's terrible, and I know it's necessary, but from the grad community, now that we approve, like we talk about who's going to get what, incoming master students, like who's going to get what offers, and it's literally like people in there saying, well, you know, there's two people that we want to come, but like I know this person has already said yes, they're coming, I don't know about this person, so we need to give them more money. And I guess that kind of shit happens.
Okay.
So we tell our undergrad students, like, if you're in a master's program, do not say yes until you get a funding package. Because if you say yes, then they're going to be like, okay, well, we don't need to give you money.
You don't have to have another bank.
Another one? What the hell are you doing to yourself?
No, it just came off.
Oh, yeah, I'm this in the car.
I'm putting my shoes on.
Putting shoes on is a dangerous
video. It is
pretty
difficult.
I brought, like, other shoes under pants, but at the hotel room, like, I don't care anymore.
Whatever.
I think you're really like the show.
I'm hosting it. Great. Yeah, I'm excited. My students, I was talking to one of them, Matt Spitzer, out there, and he was like, I've never been this excited for a concert. Like, I've been looking forward. As soon as you told me these guys were coming, I'm looking forward.
That's great.
What I want to hear, there might be a concert, an audience of five, but it'll be dedicated.
As long as they're a dedicated five, even. No.
probably know that. We are very pleased to have the Hinge Quartet with us tonight. I should also say we're very fortunate to have the Hinge Quartet with us, have them all here, because after about 24 hours of travel and cancellations due to the nor'easter that is sort of terrorizing the Northeast, finally they are all in the building and ready to take the stage, or maybe I shouldn't speak to them in that way. I could say they are going to take the stage in some cases. But anyways, so if any of you have a cell phone or any other electronic devices that might contribute some kind of impromptu musical interlude during the concert, please silence them. We'll keep the music on this side of the curtain. And I hope you all enjoy the Hinge Quartet. Thank you.
Thank you. And so Braxton, the title of the piece, the program says Composition 131, but if you look in the program notes, that drawing is actually the title of the piece. So he titles his pieces, most of his pieces, not all of them, but most of his pieces with drawings. And we use kind of a numbering system so that we can refer to them more easily than saying we're playing gas station scene with a truck on a dolly. We call this Composition 131. And Braxton has a very unique approach to composition in that he has a very illustrious and incredible career as an improviser and a free improviser and as a saxophonist as well as a composer. And his music really combines these worlds of jazz, free improv, and modern classical. But not, you know, when I say combining jazz and classical, oftentimes I think, you know, we might have maybe a Bernstein sound in our head or even a Gershwin sound, and that's not really the sound that that Braxton is going for. He's really drawing more on the sort of the freedom of our parts and also weaving in and out of improvisation from written material and into these improvisatory things. So in it we have this material that is through composed and written, and we sort of bounce in between some improvisatory material based on that and kind of go back and forth. He intends oftentimes for his pieces to be played multiple of them simultaneously. So if it was a larger group, we might have a couple of us playing this composition and a couple others playing a different one, or they might be strung together. In this case, we're just doing, you know, the one as a single standalone piece, and I think you'll hear it works really well that way. So enjoy Braxton's Composition 131.
Thank you.
Say a little word about the next piece. It's in, information is in the program note about the inspiration, but it's a really cool thing that Catherine Young based this piece on. So I just wanted to mention. So Camille's is based on a, or inspired by a book of speculative fiction by the author Donna Haraway. And a lot of times it's dealing with a sort of futuristic post-apocalyptic scenario. And I'm sure we're familiar with many of these from science fiction movies and TV shows and so forth. Many of them feature common tropes of like humans and machines merging into some kind of cyborg situation. Everything's very dehumanized and it's sort of like apocalyptic and terrible situation. In this book, though, on the other hand, the author envisions a world in which rather than humans and machines merging, we have humans merging their DNA with that of monarch butterflies. Okay, and so, and what she's imagining here is rather than a desensitization and a dehumanization, is rather a heightening of empathy, a heightening of awareness of our environment. And so this piece is a sort of sonic imagining of what the world might sound like to such a creature.
first, I just wanted to say thank you so much to East Carolina University and to Travis Alford for bringing us here. We were here for a virtual residency during the year where everything was shut down from COVID, and we're so happy to actually be here this time. So thank you so much for bringing us. So much more fun, actually. You get to come to North Carolina, eat good barbecue, and, you know, actually see everything. You can't do without just looking at the house. So, this final piece is Cook by Ed Martin, which we just premiered a couple weeks ago up in Wisconsin. We had a residency up there at University of Wisconsin Oshkosh, where Ed teaches, and we worked with him on this really awesome, exciting, killer piece. Hope you enjoy. Thank you.